Landscapes are an investment that we make. We put a lot of time, energy, and money into putting our landscapes in. But it's the maintenance that becomes important after that. All landscapes are going to need maintenance. Most of us are looking for that low maintenance, but they still require maintenance. There is an approach to that maintenance that I'd like to introduce you to. It's called IPM. Integrated pest management. We know that we'll have insects and weeds and some disease that come up. So what we're trying to do is in an economical and environmental approach, we're going to address these so that they pose less of a problem and the products we choose pose less of a threat to us as well. They're less hazardous to people, to the property, and to the environment. And it uses kind of a common sense approach. So the first thing we want to do is called monitor. And they do this same type of thing in farms as well. So you monitor the plants. You go out and you take time to smell the roses. And if I go to smell my roses, I notice the very first thing is that all the tops of my roses have been removed. And I would be a little upset had I not seen the six deer in the front yard last night feeding on the tops of these roses. But this is something you want to just kind of monitor. There are products that could be used to help to prevent that if you want these roses to be in full bloom on a regular basis. You know, continue to walk through the landscape and observe what's going on. Are there things that you're picking up? You know, here I've got this slight white tint to the outer leaves here. And if I go in and inspect it a little bit more, what I find is that I have a very bad case of scale insects that have gotten into my shrubs. So monitoring is one of the key things that you'll do. From there, you need to properly identify the problem. In this case, I said it was scale, but I probably have to go one step more and find out exactly what type of scale it is, because that's going to play a key role in how we control them. The next is evaluating. And in certain situations, for instance, my rose bush, I probably am not going to worry about doing anything with that. I'll get roses on there. If I wanted to, I could put on a preventative type material to keep them away. But there are certain times that you come in that, such as my cephalotaxis here, where that's a pretty good case. If I don't do something, I'm liable to lose the whole plant. So kind of put a threshold level on there. What are you willing to tolerate? What has to be treated? And this approach works for your vegetable garden as well as your landscape plants. So monitoring, identification, evaluation, and the last is control. And we talk about control, there's a kind of a four-part approach to that as well. The first one being cultural. That should start before you ever put your landscape in. You should soil test. Make sure you're choosing the right plant for the right location. Choosing disease and insect-resistant plants, they all fit in that cultural type of requirement. Making sure we have enough water if we have periods of drought that the plant's not under stress. Those are all cultural requirements. The next thing are mechanical, and I've got a couple of examples of mechanical right here. Weeds, for instance, one of the best mechanical control measures are your fingers. Get down and pull them out. What do they say? 1 year's weed is 7 years seed. So make sure you're pulling those. Here's another. I've got camellia's leaf gall. Easiest thing there, come in with your pruners, cut it out, get rid of it so it doesn't reinfect the plant next year. And then even traps will work. Now, I'm not a big fan of the Japanese beetle trap, but if you're going to use it, make sure you put it as far away from the plants that you want to protect. There are some traps, though, that are used for monitoring. So again, we've got cultural, we've got mechanical. The next thing we're going to look at is biological. For biological, you may have some of these in your landscape already, but these are your beneficial insects. Here we've got ladybugs, and you can see them kind of mixed in the sawdust right in there, wiggling across the top. Ladybugs feed on the aphids, and in some cases, some of that scale. You'll find them naturally in your landscape, and I'd tell you to make sure that before you control anything, you identify whether it is a pest or a beneficial. And then here I've got the praying mantis egg cases. So there's beneficials that you want to draw into your landscape. So we've got cultural, mechanical, biological, and then from there we're going to resort to the pesticides. But when we talk about pesticides, even here We've got choices. The first set of pesticides we have are the biorational. And the ones that I'm going to point out for you, these are the biochemicals. We've got the insecticidal soaps, the horticultural oils, and the plant-based products like neem. So moving from there, we move over to the next group, which are your microbial. And in this case, we've got BT products. We've got lots of different BT products out there. Choose the one that works for you. Here's the one that works on mosquitoes. We've got a BT product that works on caterpillars. And this is an organic product called Serenade that works on diseases. And it's got that microbial action to it. Another approach is going to be the inorganic products. You've got things like copper, sulfur, and boron. And at the last resort, so we've worked our way all the way through this, the last resort are your synthetic products. So you can see if you do your, you know, do your homework with this, if you actually start with that cultural, mechanical, that we can choose a lot of different products in between that are going to be less toxic or less hazardous to you and to the environment. And you may find that you do a pretty good job of keeping things maintained in your landscape.